very much. It's an enormous pleasure to be here. First, it's the end of a hard week, and soon rest will come. That will be very nice. And second, it's extremely nice to be here in front of many friends and to talk quietly about mathematics, especially on the occasion of the feast of Jean-Michel. Now, there is a rather moving text in which Jean-Michel describes all his past works and classifies them and says there is a deep unity that he understood after many, many years of work between all of this. For people a bit outside, it's difficult to see the unity. But among all the works, there is one subject which came close to some of my preoccupations at some point, and this is subjects about degenerate diffusions. I think it has not been addressed much in this conference, and I think it was important to talk about. So I immersed myself again to prepare this talk, even though I did not work on this for a few years. Now, what is the problem? I will not ridicule myself by trying to explain what were the motivations of Jean-Michel and how he applied, but at some point, he wanted to kind of interpolate between geodesic flow and elliptic operators, and for this, hypoelliptic operators were the right thing to do. Say you work on a tangent bundle or a cotangent bundle, and you have an operator which is diffusion in each fibers and which is a geodesic flow in terms of the, which is the sum of this and geodesic flow. And you put coefficients, and depending on the strength of the coefficients, you can make deformations, see how the spectrum varies from this point of view, try to make relation between an elliptic operator and this hypoelliptic operator. And there are some important geometric application also in relation with loop spaces and so on. And in all this business, in all these things, we have the basic structure. You have, say, these are the fibers. Say these are the tangent spaces, and this is the base manifold or something. Thank you. Or it's it's epsilon better.
That's much better.
Okay, much better. Good.
Yes.
At least for some time. So here, in each fiber, you have a diffusion. Diffusion has some nice effects. It has some smoothing effect. It has relaxation effect. If you have some of diffusion and drift. And so you have some relaxation occurring in each fiber. And then the geodesic flow in itself will not have some particularly diffusive effect or regularizing, but it will mix the fibers. You know, if you look at the effect of the geodesic flow, the typical thing is that it will twist things. Like if you think of this as a velocity variable, this is the position variable. Of course, you go to the right if your velocity is positive, you go to the left if your velocity is negative, so straight lines become like this, and this mixes up all the fibers. And in particular, if something sets in which is in equilibrium in each fiber but not homogeneous from fiber to fiber, the geodesic flow will take the job to mix this whole thing. With this kind of things in mind, look, for instance, the problem of regularization. Imagine we put a diffusion like this in fibers and press the geodesic flow. And imagine I look at some singularity of some function which is distributed like this. If I apply some diffusion in velocity space, in tangent space, in each fiber, of course, this will spread. And maybe there will be a spread like a square root of t, which is typical of some diffusion. If, on the other hand, I have a singularity which is like this, concentrated along a fiber, of course, the fact that there is this singularity, the diffusion will not change anything. But if I apply the geodesic flow, my singularity will be twisted. Here in time t, which is small, there will be an angle which is about t. And then the diffusion will be able to set in. And there will be a factor distance square root of t from this. If you look at this, apply trigonometry, you see that the distance from here to here is about t to the 3/2. And you see here two important things. First, that we have a competition. On one hand, there is the relaxation effect in each factor, on the other, which is geometrically trivial. On the other hand, there is a geometrically non-trivial action of the geodesic flow, which mixes the variables. And we have this typical exponent 3 diffusion in position space will be three times smaller in terms of exponent, three times this is there is a power three in terms of the exponents of the distance as here. It's like we were regularizing three times as fast in velocity than in position. And this three exponent is characteristic of the geometric nature of this kind of things. Now, Jean-Michel was interested in problems of convergence to equilibrium, in problems of regularization for such operators, in cases in which you look, for instance, at functions, but also at vector-valued things. And but this kind of problematics doesn't appear only in geometry. It is very well present in many problems of physics, even though not so popular, not so familiar, even among physicists. Here are typical situations that you encounter in many partial differential equations. You will have in your equation a kind of conservative part, think of geodesic flow, and the dissipative part, such that the conservative part alone, of course, does not induce relaxation in the usual sense of convergence to some thermodynamical equilibrium, for instance. And the dissipative part is degenerate. It will not be sufficient either. But if you have the combination of the two with some nice geometric relation, then you can have relaxation coming in. And it's a general problem, on which I worked a lot at some point, about how the convergence will look like as time goes to infinity, how fast or how it is qualitatively and so on. Here is a typical numerical simulation that you can do for a true particle model, Boltzmann equation. These are simulations first made by Francis Philbert around 2004. These kind of simulations require very accurate schemes. These are rather high dimensional equations. And here is what you obtain. So how to read this? This is a logarithmic scale. Here it's the entropy, or rather it's negative. And this is, say, the total entropy of the gas with respect to some rest state. The more you go down, the closer you are to the global equilibrium, which will be the state of maximum physical entropy. And you see the curve here. It does like this. It approaches equilibrium, the gas, but not in a typical way. You know, because this is logarithmic scale, you would expect a kind of straight line. You see here, it's not really straight. Here, it's even less. You see, you have these kind of oscillations type. The oscillations are even more apparent if you take an intermediate step and replace, so this is for a gas in which you look at velocities and positions. If you look only at positions and consider a hydrodynamic approximation and ask how far your gas is from being hydrodynamic. And this is measured by this distance here. So when the two curves are together, This means that the gas is almost in hydrodynamic level when they are far away, and when they are very close to each other, gas is almost homogeneous. So here we start in an essentially hydrodynamic state, and here we are very little hydrodynamic. The amount of kinetic, you know, variation between hydrodynamic and the gas is measured by this distance. And you see here how the gas becomes more hydrodynamic, less hydrodynamic, more hydrodynamic, less hydrodynamic, etc. So in some respects, after you think about it from the right point of view, after it, you may end up thinking that it is obvious in retrospect. That is essentially where I arrived. But at the time when this was out, all the specialists of Boltzmann equation were surprised. When these were presented in conference, people said, we never seen anything like this, and so on, showing that even for physicists, this kind of problematics in which you have both conservative and degenerate dissipative thing are not familiar. And precisely, this is a situation in which we have a competition between conservative term and the degenerate dissipative term. What is the difference between the two figures? These both are simulations of a gas in a box. The difference is that this is in a regime in which the size of the box is smaller, and here the size of the box is larger. By making the size of the box smaller, in a way, we enhance, or larger, we may enhance the effects that are associated with the transport operator, more like homogenization, or with the diffusion operator, which is more like relaxation to thermodynamical equilibrium. Let us continue this discussion. Let me give a few typical examples to make the discussion more concrete with the mathematical models. So typically in kinetic theory, your unknown is a distribution function in which it depends on time. Yes, it's a bit weak. Okay, no problem. It depends on time, on position x, and on velocity v. And at each time t, you look what is the density of particles in the space of positions and velocity. Typically, it is a tangent space, natural phase space for particles. And a simple model, simpler than Boltzmann equation, but with a lot of structure, would be the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, in which, physically speaking, you have a gradient force. So if you look just at this is the Newton equation, like the force is identical to the acceleration. Here, let us put a friction term, and here, some noise. So it's like a white noise, a force acting on the particles. So you put white noise, you put a confinement potential, you put friction. Because there is confinement, your system will not escape to infinity. White noise tends to give energy to the system, but friction tends to take out energy from the system, and you may expect that there is a stationary regime in the end. From the point of view of partial differential equations, if you look at the Fokker-Planck equation associated to this diffusion process, here is how it is. You have first a first-order operator, which is like a distorted geodesic flow, which is a first-order operator, so it's a derivation. And the second-order operator, or a combination of second and first order, which acts only on the velocity variable, on the kinetic variable. So here you have the conservative part, which is geometrically non-trivial. Within phase space, typically, it makes trajectories like this in XV. And here, this is geometrically trivial in the sense that it acts on each fiber independently of the others. But there is a phenomena of diffusion, of relaxation to equilibrium. How do the two combine, and how can we approach this? Here is a more complicated model, Razov-Landau equation. This one is nonlinear. I will not write it explicitly now. This is one that is very well known in plasma physics, sometimes called the classical standard model in plasma physics, in which it's like this for the left-hand side, except that the force is induced by the particles themselves. Instead of being a given confinement potential, it is a potential which is induced by all the other particles, typically by electrostatic interaction. So the force depends on F itself, and here you have a quadratic term. And on the right-hand side, you also have a quadratic term, but of quite different nature, more Boltzmann type. It is complicated. I will show it at the very end of the talk. For the moment, you don't need to see exactly what it is. But like this one, it acts only on the velocity variable. It is quadratic, it is a divergence type operator, and it has properties both of regularization and of convergence to equilibrium in the velocity variable. Here is a third example, Boltzmann equation. Typically, say you put it in a periodic box, for instance, in a torus, you have transport phenomena, just particles want to go in straight line if they are not, if nothing is wrong. And from time to time, they hit each other. These are the collisions. And these collisions are modeled by a complicated integral bilinear operator, which acts only on the velocity. In this case, sometimes this is regularizing, sometimes not. It is diffusive in a rather broad sense of phenomena that has a tendency, an arrow of time, and so on. But it may be not regularizing. It depends on the kind of interaction that you have at microscopic level. But in all cases, this one has a property of convergence to equilibrium in the velocity variable. And when you study these things, always the problem is to put the two properties together, properties of the transport or anti-symmetric guy and properties of the symmetric degenerate guy or collision guy. Here is the collision operator of Boltzmann. This is the example corresponding to Hartsphere. You see that it is quadratic. This corresponds to the fact that there are interactions between pairs of particles. There is depends only on the velocity. I did not put the dependence on t and x here, which is implicit, because it doesn't act on the x variable, only on the velocity variable, in the same way as in the kinetic Fokker-Planck, I had a diffusion only in the velocity variable. And there are some rules for collisions. You go from the pre-collisional velocities to the post-collisional velocities. And this operator has some relaxation properties. In particular, if you look at what is its kernel, so to speak, it's not a linear operator, but you can look what are the distributions that make it vanish. And it's a very small kernel, so to speak, only the distributions which have a Gaussian dependence in the velocity variable. So it's like it's more precise than Gaussian. It has to have an isotropic. It has to have a matrix which is just a number, the covariance matrix. So here you have it depends only on three parameters: this equilibrium, total mass, the temperature, which measures if your distribution is very much spread or very much concentrated, and the mean velocity. And these parameters, it's exactly as in there. They may change from fiber to fiber if you try to solve the equation, the right-hand side equal to zero. But then, if the gas wants to settle in a state in which all these parameters would be different, the geodesic flow, which corresponds to this operator here, would come in and mix the fibers together. And if you want to understand relaxation to equilibrium for a classical gas, you have to understand this effect. So this hypoelliptic kind of problematics is really there in many basic models of physics. I already told you the difficulties. So for both equations, the dissipative part acts only on the variable V. The Boltzmann equation ceases to be dissipative on hydrodynamical states. Like the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, ceases to be dissipative on states which are multiples fiber-wise of the Gaussian. And if you want to understand relaxation, you have to use cleverly the conservative part if you ever come close to these states which are partially relaxed. For Boltzmann equation, you have additional difficulties. Of course, it's nonlinear. It's complicated. For linear equations, sometimes you have many Lyapunov functionals. For Boltzmann equation, there is only one which is known in general, that is the entropy. And okay, entropy production is tricky. I will go to this a bit later. 1965, we have this very interesting text by Harold Grad. Grad, together with Katz, is one of the two mathematicians of the time who did a lot to turn Boltzmann equation from physics to mathematical subjects, following the early works of Kahneman and others. This is 1965, so it's very close to the works by Hermander on hypoellipticity that we recall later, the 1967 theorem of Hermander on sums of squares. And Grad had this in a paper that is rather obscure. He had this excellent intuition. The paper is full of ideas. It's also full of mistakes. It's very interesting. And the question is whether the deviation from a local Maxwellian, which is fed by molecular streaming in the presence of spatial inhomogeneity, is sufficiently strong to ultimately wipe out the inhomogeneity. So this, if you read behind the lines, is the same kind of picture that I was drawing here. And there, a valid proof of approach to equilibrium in a spatially varying problem requires just the opposite of the procedure that is followed in the proof of the H theorem. H theorem is the theorem of Boltzmann according to which entropy always goes up. And he said, so this is Videlicet, to show that the distribution function does not approach too closely to a local Maxwellian. What Grad wanted to say is that if we want to prove that the gas goes to equilibrium, it better avoid the states which are partially in equilibrium, those which are in equilibrium at each position. Because when it is in such a state, entropy production becomes very small, vanishes, even though we are not at equilibrium. So we want to show that we stay away from these states. He had this very good intuition, which is kind of opposite to the intuition that many people, including physicists, have. If you discuss with physicists very often about the asymptotic behavior of Boltzmann equation, they will tell you what it does typically is first there is convergence to local Maxwellian varying from time to time, and then on a longer time scale, it rests a bit like the Navier-Stokes equation or something like this. And this is not true. And Grad had understood it very clearly what was the right picture. Let me see how. Let me first give a little bit of bibliography. bibliography may not be up to date because I did not check on the very recent results, but for kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, to summarize, the first convergence results were obtained by probabilistic methods, using things like Lyapunov methods in probability theory and so on. And in 2001, with Laurent Desvillettes, we obtained for the first time a convergence at the level of the distribution function, which was very fast in the sense of faster than any inverse power of time, under some assumptions at infinity, which were quite strong, and some restriction on the data, which was quite strong too. But this was some progress in the understanding. A few years later, Hérault and Nier obtained the first exponential convergence for the distribution function under the assumption that the ratio of F0 of the initial datum by the rest state is in L2, so in L2 setting. This was the first really good result of exponential convergence. It was followed by other results by Elfer and Nier, by Hérault, and so on, using in particular techniques coming from hypolipticity, a la cone, and so on. Quantitative cone-type hypolyptic methods. For Boltzmann equation, let me not say exactly which are the boundary conditions that you need and so on. In 2005, with Desvillettes, we proved a conditional result that whenever you have uniform smoothness and positivity, then you have the convergence, which is also very fast, and you can convert your smoothness bounds into decay bounds. At the time, this was this result, which applied in all cases in which you had smoothness, in particular in the close-to-equilibrium regime, at the time was the only known quantitative estimate of this type. Later, Guo and Strain showed that there is a more precise result when you are close to equilibrium. The convergence is indeed like an exponential or a fractional exponential, depending on the interaction that you look at. Let me remind that for Boltzmann equation in the large, we don't know any regularity estimate. This is one of the problems that has most haunted me in the past years and probably in the future years. Our method with Laurent Desvillettes was based on the coupling of functional inequality. So there was this idea of reducing the problem and the geometry and the physics of the problem to some functional inequalities on meaningful quantities and look for differential inequalities between these functionals. And I told you always the important thing is to see how to marry, how to put together the information from the fibers, so collisional part, and the information coming from the twisting part, the transport. In this case, this were ingredient A, a lower bound on the entropy production, far from hydrodynamic state, which was an information theoretical nature, telling you if in some fiber I am far from the Maxwellian, from the Gaussian equilibrium, then a lot of entropy will be produced in that fiber, and this will get me closer to equilibrium. And for the other, it was the instability of hydrodynamic approximation in presence of gradients, meaning if in each fiber it looks like a Gaussian, so like hydrodynamic state, but if the parameters are inhomogeneous, then the situation is unstable under the geodesic flow. This is exactly the translation of the intuition of Grad. To put things together, there was geometric inequalities like Poincaré inequality, Korn inequality, in particular to encode the shape of the domain. And in the end, it boiled down to a study of system of differential inequalities, Grönwall style, just a bit more complicated. Also, like the analytic glue together, there was a lot of interpolation. In particular, systematically looking for good rates, which means you want good exponents in your inequalities, trading it, if necessary, via interpolation inequalities for smoothness. So you sacrifice a lot of smoothness in order to have very good exponents. Let's say more about this intermediate state hydrodynamic approximation. If you want to say that gas is partially or not to in equilibrium, so if it is or not near hydrodynamic approximation, let us see how we can replace it by a hydrodynamic approximation, some kind of projection. What is the best approximation of a distribution f of x and v by a hydrodynamic state, which is a state which is Gaussian in velocity and can have parameters depending on x otherwise? Well, there is a standard recipe that we know from physics. If you integrate in velocity, you obtain the physical density. This is the density like of fluid. And if you take the mean velocity according to distribution f, you obtain something like a macroscopic velocity. And if you look at the variance, you obtain something that you will call the temperature. These three parameters, rho, u, and t, are the three hydrodynamic variables that appear in all hydrodynamic equations. And this process gives you a kind of projection operator. From each f, I can construct a Maxwellian approximation. This is like a nonlinear projection operator, which is very natural. Sometimes some people, especially in the school around typing U, call, especially in the linear context, call this micro-macro decomposition. There is this idea that there is this intermediate step before equilibrium in which you put things at equilibrium only in the various fibers. Entropy production in Boltzmann equation. Entropy is this first, up to a sign. So this is the negative of the entropy, integral of f log f. And the production of entropy is this complicated integral. In three-dimensional space of velocity, this is the eightfold integral. And it is always non-negative because a minus b times log a over b is non-negative, whatever a and b. I'm sorry that the sign here is wrong. Yes, there should be a minus in front of all this. For some time, I worked with other people on the problem of putting a lower bound on this, like a nonlinear version of the spectral gap problem. You see how much some quantity is dissipated, and you want to express how much it is dissipated in terms of how far it is from the rest state. What was called the Cherchignani conjecture at some point was the fact that you would have this inequality with the power 1 here, that is, the production of entropy would be bounded below by a multiple of the difference of entropies between the distribution and its hydrodynamic projection, if I may say. Now it is known that in general it is false, but you can always take epsilon as small as you want, at least if you allow it to depend on regularity of f and positivity. To know whether you can dispense with the regularity and the positivity, maybe looking only for moments, is still an open problem. Now, once you have this, let me show you, in the end, the system at which we arrived. The system looks a bit ugly, but I remember I was very excited when we had this system, like, because it was like really understanding why and how the gas will converge to equilibrium in terms of having some active mechanism of differential inequalities. So the system consists of one inequality, which is about the production of entropy in terms of whether you are far from hydrodynamic state. And then there are other inequalities related in terms of the distance from the distribution function to the hydrodynamic state. And there are three of them, depending how much you project. You can project keeping the physical density, velocity, and temperature, or you can decide to also average the temperature of the box and comparing this to a state in which the temperature is average, or you can also put the temperature to the final rest state and compare this to to a state in which only the distribution rho varies. Or you could compare it to a state, this is m, is the final state in which you have reached everything. So let's see how it works and why this system implies the convergence to equilibrium. Forget about the error terms here. See here, as long as f is far from hydrodynamic, then you have a lot, some non-trivial amount of entropy which is produced. You approach equilibrium because the distance between h of f and h of the equilibrium diminishes. If f becomes very close to the Maxwellian, local Maxwellian, this inequality is of no use. But then turn to the next inequality. See, so this is the case in which this guy is very close from this guy. So this quantity is very small. But here I'm looking at the second derivative of the square norm. And here, forget about this term too, in the right-hand side there is a term including the integral of the gradient of the temperature to the square. So it tells you, if I am hydrodynamic, but the temperature is inhomogeneous from place to place, then this quantity is positive. So this square norm is convex. If a function is strictly convex and it's very small at some point, then it will have to grow again. So the distance between f and its projection will grow again, and I will be back to the first situation. That is in the case where gradient t is non-trivial. If gradient t is trivial, then t is close to be equal to its average value, so you go to the third inequality. And then this inequality will tell you again, if there are non-trivial symmetrized gradient of u, that the distance between f and the projection to the distributions with average temperature will grow again. And this will hold as long as you don't have non-trivial gradients of u. And if there are trivial gradients of u, you turn to the final equations, and this will do the job. So this was the idea. And working on this, so I told you it's Grönwall in spirit, but because it's four equations, and there is second order and first order, it's a mess. So we proved that if you have these inequalities, it converges to equilibrium, at least like t to the minus 1 over 200 epsilon. Epsilon was as small as you want, so you had the convergence as fast as you want. This was the proof back in 2005. After this, for some time, me and other people interested worked on, first, find simpler methods to attack the same thing, maybe less intuitive, maybe less close to the ideas of Grad, but that are simpler technically to put in operation. And identify general structures, gathering various models with a degenerate diffusive part, and start some kind of toolbox. Something like, here is a set of tricks and methods. If you guys encounter some equation which has these features, then maybe you can try to apply this or that trick. How to do this? First, let me recall you what I was telling at the very beginning of the talk. Often in PDE, you have this association of conservative part and dissipative part with mixing conservative part and the degenerate dissipative part, and the combination of the two will lead to relaxation. And as I said also in the beginning, there is an analogy with hypolipticity theory. To simplify things a lot, the basic results about hypolipticity is you have a first-order part, a second-order part, such that the first-order part does not induce any regularization, and the second-order part is degenerate, but the combination of the two leads to regularization. This is not the official definition of hypolipticity, but in common language, usually, this is often what we mean. Accordingly, following a suggestion by Thierry Gallet, I decided to use the denomination hypocoercivity to talk about the first situation. Hypocoercivity is the same as hypolipticity, except that hypolipticity is about regularization. Hypocoercivity is about going to equilibrium, to kernel, to trivial state. Now, recall the most important theorem in the theory of regularization, hypolitic regularization. So this is 1967. Hermander obtains, he's motivated by the example of kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, which had been solved explicitly by Kolmogorov. And Hermander obtains a rather general theorem in which you look at the sum of squares of first-order operators plus another first-order operator. So here, you identify by the usual trick your differentiation operators, say on a manifold, to vector fields, which is like you differentiate in the direction of the vector field. And let us look at it in the dynamic version, in which you look at the parabolic type equation, or the time derivative, is given by the sum of the squares of the xi plus x0, all this acting on u. Can you see that there is regularization or not? In the elliptic case, where all the xi's generate the whole of the dimension of the tangent space, you have symphinity regularization. The theorem of Hermander is that if, by looking at Lie brackets of finite numbers of these derivations appearing, the x0 and the xi's, if by taking these Lie brackets you can generate all directions, then you are still symphinity regularizing. And the important thing here, you see, is some kind of geometric condition. It is a geometric condition. You take commutators between the derivations which appear here, and you want to generate all the directions. This theorem is a local theorem. It's extremely robust. It's the same whether on Rn or manifold and so on. And it is simple. It is not, there are refinements and so on, but for most cases, it will do the job, for many cases. Now, here is the result which I obtained by analogy with this Hermander theorem. I call it A star A plus B theorem, just recalling what is the result. First comment is that it is much less general than Hermander in the sense that it needs more structure assumption. This is natural. Regularization is a local phenomenon. converging to equilibrium is something global, you need more symmetries, and so on. On the other hand, it doesn't rely on a basic real analysis, so it's an abstract theorem. You don't need it to be defined on Rn and so on. You can state this result on a Hilbert space, and it's an abstract linear result. So here is what it is. Take A1, etc., AM, which are operators, unbounded operators. And take B, which is anti-symmetric, on some Hilbert space. And set L is A star A plus B, so this is sum of AJ star AJ plus B. This is like dissipative, this is like symmetric, it may be degenerate, and this is anti-symmetric. And I will do commutators. First commutator I will call A. Let's forget that there are several of them, otherwise you have to work with all the arrays. The first A, let's say, is the zeroth stage of the commutators, and then I will obtain commutator after commutator by always making the bracket with B. So I obtain this way C1, C2, etc. And maybe there are remainders that I put in, so here in some remainder R, and I impose that after some finite number of steps, I arrive at zero, that is, everything will be in the remainder in the identity. Then some technical assumption that I will not insist on, that some of these commutators between A and the CK should be bounded with respect to some earlier commutators. And one important assumption that at the end of the process, sum of CJ star CJ should be a coercive operator. This is the abstract version of the Hermander condition that you generate all directions. This means we really have something after looking at all these commutators, we look at all the whole list, it should not neglect any direction of convergence to equilibrium. Now, if all this is satisfied, then when you look at the evolution operator associated to L, you can find some norm which is of this form, which is equivalent to this form in Hilbert sense, in which the convergence is exponential. Yes, this norm will do. And you can compute explicitly lambda in terms of all the constants which appear in your assumptions. So if, under some conditions, by looking at successive commutators of these A with the B, I can generate all directions in the sense of constructing some coercive operator, then I have the exponential convergence. Let us apply it to the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation. In this case, take as a Hilbert space L2 with a weight which is the equilibrium measure. Your operator A will be gradient in velocity, so this is like n operators, one for each direction v. There are d dimensions of velocity, d dimensions of position, and the operator B will be the operator of distorted geodesic flow. And the assumptions of the theorem will be satisfied as soon as, first, the Hessian of V is bounded essentially by the gradient of V, say convergence is essentially not faster than exponential or something like this. And second, exponential minus V should satisfy a Poincaré inequality, a spectral gap identity, if you want, for the associated operator. Whenever these two assumptions are satisfied, then you have an exponential convergence of the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, and the rate is constructive. As I said, I did not check if there were very recent results that are finer, but when this was proven, it was the most available general result, recovering the general results of Hérault, Nier, Elfer, and so on. And here we see this, how here it really has nothing to do, in some sense, with hypolipticity, because we could obtain it applying an abstract result which doesn't care if the space is Rn or whatever. We don't care about regularization in this theorem. And this was interesting also because the proof of the previous proofs used a lot, the regularization together with the convergence to equilibrium. The core of the proof is totally elementary, which is good because it means that it is flexible. You introduce a Lyapunov functional, which is equivalent to the kind of H1 functional that would be obtained by looking at Sobolev-type norm. You take the L2 norm, well, the square norm, plus a combination of the norm which is in direction A and the norm which is in direction A bracket B. If you recall, in the standard case, say if you look like grad V and you take the bracket with V grad X, then up to a sign, this is grad X. This is the fundamental commutator identity, which is at the basis of hypolytic regularization, and which here also at the basis of the theorem. But here, these are abstract operator, and we have this direction A bracket B. And instead of working with this norm, we shall distort this norm by introducing another term. This term, it will be a scalar product between AH and ABH. And you will choose the coefficients in such a way that this intermediate term is negligible in front of the others. Say the constants A, B, and C will be such that A is greater than B, which is greater than C, and B will be much smaller than square root of A times C, so that you can always absorb this by Cauchy-Schwarz into both, and this norm really is equivalent to this one without the term. But when we look at the properties, the differential properties of this norm, it will make a lot of difference that you put this term. It will make a lot of difference because the operator will not give the same result when you apply it, with to this lower order term or not. Okay. So the key algebraic identity is the following one. When you apply the AND operator, remember, always the problem is to use in a clever way the B part, the antisymmetric part. Let us differentiate in the direction B this particular scalar product. So there are two terms, one term in which I apply B on the left side and one term in which I apply B on the right side. And now I will make this A bracket B and B commute up to some error term, and then the B I can put here in front of the AB. And since B is anti-symmetric, I will put it here on the left side in front of A up to changing a sign. But then this will recreate AB minus BAH, scalar product AB minus BAH, so it will be the square of A bracket BH. Now, if you have this is a good term, it will give you a positive term in the AB direction in your norms. And the rest of the game is to control this iterated commutator. This is where you need to put some structural assumptions so that things are not too bad. Okay, that is the key. This is not unrelated to tricks that were used already for some times in different contexts by Yan Gu on one hand, by Denitali on the other hand, for regularity problems. And one can also use similar Lyapunov functionals, similar tricks, to prove the Hermander hypolytic regularity bounds in a quantitative way, in a global regularization way. This I worked on at some point, and Hero also worked on at some point. Let me give you one example to show the flexibility of this, and let me show you how with very elementary tools prove regularization for this kinetic Fokker-Planck equation in a non-standard context of L1 initial data. Say you start from a measure data and you don't want to stay in a L2 context. And you want to prove that at time t, your distribution function will be Sobolev in variables x and v, starting from zero regularity, just assuming some moment bounds, and you're looking for a global theorem. Because of the behavior at infinity, note carefully, there will never be any regularization from L1 into L2 if you apply it with the, if you look with a measure. There is a problem with the behavior at infinity. Now, here is a proof, a possible proof in four steps. The first will be to go from L1 initial datum to flat Sobolev regularity. I say flat Sobolev is regularity with a weight that is Lebesgue weight and not the equilibrium weight. So it's a much lower regularity estimate than with the L2 estimate. First step, you look for an energy estimate with an energy functional that is devised by taking all kinds of combinations of regularities in X and V, except that you always take three times higher derivatives, maximum derivatives in velocity than in position. This is adapted to the scale of regularity that you expect, in which it will be three times more regular in velocity than in position. And this norm will be equivalent to a norm in which you have m derivatives in x, 3m derivatives in v, plus a lower order term maybe, but you will choose the coefficients here in a non-trivial way. And if you choose them in the right way, when you look at the time derivative, will appear a term which is just one step higher in velocity only. This is the first step, a partial regularization, a partial dissipation estimate. Second, look at some mixed derivatives. So introduce in some lower order term, which is negligible with respect to the energy norm, a combination of gradient X and gradient V. It is the analog of the scalar product of before. Use the famous commutator identity and obtain some good term in the direction X with the right number of derivatives. Third, interpolate. You will need to interpolate various terms depending on regularity in X, regularity in V. In this L1 context, the right interpolation inequalities are not L2 inequalities, but Nash-type inequalities, which interpolate between L1 bound and regularity bound. And you can play on the exponents in position, in velocity. You have all kinds of exponents coming in. The usual Nash inequality will be just the X variable, or maybe X and V variable at the same level, and look here at regularity of order 1 and order 1 here. And the fourth step, solve the differential inequalities that you obtain. So there was this energy which is equivalent to some more classical norm. By interpolation, we have a bound between the lower order term and the energy. So delta is positive here. Here comes the good derivative in velocity coming from the diffusion. Here comes the good derivative in position coming from the anti-symmetric part here. Sorry, it's here. And these delta and theta here come from the Nash interpolation inequalities. And now it's just a problem of differential inequalities that this system implies that automatically, for finite time, the energy is bounded with a characteristic exponent that depends only on the exponents delta and theta. So this is one very elementary way to obtain these regularity bounds in Sobolev norms for the flat kinetic Fokker-Planck equations. You see, it's very robust, and then you can also venture in much more exotic contexts under certain assumptions. Assume, for instance, you work in an L log L context, like you're interested in entropic type estimates. And in this context, derivatives of integral f log f are things like integral f grad log f squared, things that look like Fisher information type. You can look at a functional in which you put adequate powers of t in front of terms which are Fisher information in velocity variables, in position variables, or a mix of both. This is adapting a trick by Hero. And again, if you compute the coefficients well, this functional will be contracting. And you have a typical power, t to the minus 3, which is the right one in this sense. One thing that I don't know if there is a deep reason for this or if it's just accident, is that in this business, computations are almost similar if you work with h squared or h log h. More precisely, don't look at the details, but when you look in the direction a star a h, you time differentiate a functional like integral ch squared. You obtain three terms with certain commutator structure. If you do the same with integral of h c log h squared, you obtain the same three terms, just you replace h by log, plus an additional term which has a form of sum of commutators, which automatically disappears if a is equal to c by some symmetry between indices. But in general, it's only this term, this extra term, that you have to control if you want to do it with log h. This is similar with what obtains in Bakri-Emery computations, in which you look at second-order differentials of entropy. But in Bakri-Emery, there is a nice calculus, there are tricks, there are rules, you know why it works. Here, I have no idea why it works. The proof is just by brute force, making many integration by parts and chain rule. So maybe there is some nice structure underlying this, maybe some geometric properties, I don't know. Let me conclude with the two results that are obtained with these methods for kinetic Fokker-Planck equations. One first result about convergence in L1, if your potential has a bounded Hessian, and you can prove a logarithmic Sobolev inequality for the rest state, and you have some control of second moments, then you have convergence in L1 norm and in entropy, and it is exponentially fast. Convergence in L2 will hold if, this was what I said, if there is a Poincaré inequality and a bound like Hessian is bounded above by the gradient of the velocity. This is typically more strong than this, and this is of course more strong than this, and this is of course more strong than this. It's normal. Convergence in L1 is more stringent in this business than convergence in L2, in particular because of the tails problem. Okay, so in this case, it is not bad. I remark also that there is a completely different approach to exponential convergence for this equation in which L1 by Martin Heyer and Jonathan Mattingly. Now, what about nonlinear models? So far, it looked good, but these were problems A star A plus B. It's linear, it's a very particular structure. When you have in front of you some ugly nonlinear models, what to do? So with the idea that it would also be good to set it in abstract terms, here is how I can formulate a theorem. Now, this theorem will not be in one Hilbert space. It will be a scale in a scale of Banach spaces. A bit like, yes, Jean-Michel. Okay. It will be in a scale of Banach spaces. It's about the same philosophy that you have in Nash-Moser theorem, in which you work at the same time with a scale of norms, which encode various levels of regularity, and you jump from one norm to the other. Here, we'll do the same. And this parameter S looks for regularity, but it will be abstract here. And let's assume that these spaces are in interpolation, that X0 is Hilbert, that your solution is uniformly bounded in all your regularity spaces. So you know how to solve the Cauchy problem in some good sense. You don't make any assumption of linearity, but you make the assumption that you know how to have good bounds in this scale of Banach spaces. And let us assume that your operators are Lipschitz with possible loss of derivatives. Again, this is like a bit inspired from Nash-Moser type theorems. That B is conservative in some weak sense and C dissipative in some weak sense. I will say a bit more later. That you have one stationary state and the Lyapunov functional which controls the distance to the stationary state in your norm X0. And now, we cannot do commutators any longer with this kind of things. We don't have linear operators at our disposal. But we will use the projection operators which mimic the operation of taking the hydrodynamic projection that was moments ago. So let us introduce a chain of nonlinear projection operators. Let's assume they are smooth, possibly with loss of derivatives, and that they are nested, so that when you compose pi j with pi k, it will be pi of max of jk. These are like more and more precise approximations of the equilibrium, if you want. You introduce them by force. They don't appear in the equation. You introduce them. And we'll assume, so here is some simplified set of assumptions. I will explain you in words what this means morally. So think like pi 1 is like what takes you to the first projection. Typically, it is a state which is in equilibrium in each fiber, but not globally in equilibrium. And we assume that our Lyapunov functional will control the distance to this first projection. And we assume also that you can bound the distance between the first projection to the equilibrium state by essentially the X0 norm, possibly with loss of exponents, which is a very weak assumption in this context in which you have bounds. We assume that B is conservative in a very weak sense, just in the sense that it doesn't change the Lyapunov functional, that it keeps it invariant. And we will assume that C is dissipative degenerate in the sense that you can bound below the dissipation induced by C by some power of the distance between F and the first projection. And we will assume so these are some conditions which are not a problem, that the projection are really all inside the kernel of the collision operator. And we assume this. And this is the condition that will replace, in this context, the Hermander type condition of looking in all directions. We will assume that the difference between one projection and the other is controlled by the contribution in the time derivative of the remainder of the projection with respect to the function itself by the contribution of the conservative operator. This is the condition. If this is true, if all this is true, then you have the convergence to equilibrium. Okay, this set of assumptions looks complicated, but when you apply it to real situation like Boltzmann equation, for instance, it is really much simpler to apply this as a black box and checking the assumptions than to go through the differential equation analysis that was at the beginning of my talk. In a non-axisymmetric box, for instance, you will use three projections. Depending on the boundary conditions, you will change the projectors and so on. here is an example of nonlinear convergence result that you can obtain with this. Take the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation, but induce a dependence between the distribution function and the force. Put a coupling. Don't put a very singular coupling that like there is in real life. Put a smooth potential, because life is hard. Put a C2 potential, put this in the torus, and ask yourself, is there convergence to equilibrium or not for this equation in which particles interact? And there is diffusion in the fibers, and there is a force which is self-induced. First, is there a unique equilibrium? Well, you can show that if the maximum of the potential, say the oscillation of the potential is strictly bounded by one, then there is a unique equilibrium. In general, there is not a unique equilibrium. If you increase the strength of the potential, you will reach problems of transition of phase and so on. But if the potential is small enough, there is a unique equilibrium. I don't know how to prove to obtain explicit rates of convergence under this assumption, but applying the abstract result I showed you, if the maximum of the potential is, say, bounded by 0.38, then you do have the convergence. And again, this will work as a black box, using here a simple projection operator. In this case, this nonlinear case, again, the trick is very simple. We will correct the Lyapunov functional by the addition of some lower order terms, in which the constants will be chosen recursively, and in the terms, I put by force B, and I put by force the projections, and also their functional derivative. And this thing will work after some, it is slightly messy computation, but if you keep it in abstract formulation, it is much easier than if you do it explicitly, directly on the functional. For instance, this procedure gives you automatically, for the Boltzmann equation, the following Lyapunov functional. Obviously, you don't want to deal with this, but this is another case in which it's good to work with abstract formalism. Okay, let me, here I'm arriving at the end of that time, let me mention very briefly that these methods with commutators also work with slightly more unconventional models, like here this one, Landau-Lipschitz-Gilbert-Maxwell, a simplification of some magnetism model. It's a vector system. It is quite degenerate. You see the only diffusion part here, there is a double curl. So from the geometric point of view, it is only in one direction. Here it's still of the form A star A plus B, and you need three commutators this time until you obtain the convergence. But still the general theorem applies. Also see this problem that was studied by Gallagher, Gallet, Nier. Look at this problem which arises from a study of incompressible flow. A scene vortex is some kind of situation in two-dimensional, some asymptotic regime in two-dimensional Euler equation, in which the rest state is a single Dirac function in vorticity, so it corresponds to a big vortex. In a simplified model, you end up studying spectral properties of an operator depending on some parameter epsilon, which is a sum of what? This is a harmonic oscillator, basically. And there is an purely imaginary part in which f is some particular function with some Gaussian features, and so there is I here. Question, what is the spectral behavior of this guy as epsilon goes to zero? Obviously, there is a uniform lower bound because this guy has a spectral gap and this is imaginary. But it may be that the combination of this and this gives better than a uniform spectral gap. And indeed, the anti-symmetric part, as was discovered by Gallagher, Gallet, and Nier, enhances the dissipation by a factor epsilon to the minus 1/2. So this 1 over epsilon anti-symmetric part and this symmetric part with the uniform spectral gap combine together to give a pseudo-spectral gap, which is like epsilon to the minus 1/2. How to prove this? They tested two methods. The first was kind of, let's call it hard approach, localize the spectrum with micro-local techniques, semi-classical asymptotics, Arayer-Mander, Sjöstrand, Zvorsky, Helfer, Nier, and you get that the real part of the spectrum of the operator is all bounded below by constant times epsilon to the minus 1/2. Second method, apply my A star A plus B trick, and don't try to prove such a strong result. Try to just look at the evolution problem and see if the evolution has a relaxation rate, which is like epsilon to the minus 1/2. So again, we'll have A star A plus B. A will be dx plus x. B will be 1 over epsilon f. The functional will be, again, of the same usual type, with a term, intermediate term, which is controlled by the two, the first and the last term, but which is important to put here. And then you have to work quite a bit. This they did, but in the end, you obtain the same rate, epsilon to the minus 1/2, than you had with the other method. So in terms of pseudo-spectrum, so to say, you recover the right rate with this. So I think it's good to know that there is, in parallel to the classical approaches based on microlocal analysis and so on, this other approach based on twisting your norm with a lower order term. In some situations, one will work. In other situations, the other will work. Anyway, it's good to have them. Let me skip this because I'm out of time. There are other issues about what you do when you have linear operators, but which are Boltzmann type. You know, a Boltzmann operator is like integral. It will be a big mess if you start to write it as A star A. You don't want to take the square root of some big convolution operator. Instead, introducing projection operators as it was done for the nonlinear case and working out clever conditions, Dolbeau-Mouch-Meiser showed how to construct a norm for such cases, which again is obtained by twisting with a lower order term, but will be contracting if you choose it carefully. And I will end up with a few mysteries, at least things that tormented me a bit and that I, okay, I still don't know what to think, and maybe Jean-Michel will comment on this. I remember we had the one exchange about, several exchanges with Jean-Michel about things like this, and I was impressed each time I would send some question, he would reply with this long email, like at some point it was a simple question, should we study the hypoliptic Laplacian in tangent or cotangent variables? And then Jean-Michel, oh, it's a very important problem, I thought a lot about it, etc. In the end, he didn't know, but it was always refreshing to read this enthusiasm. Okay, so this is a qualitative understanding of the role of confinement. So you see, from physical point of view, if you have a system like Boltzmann equation, you cannot really act on the characteristics, microscopic characteristics of the gas. But you can ask on the boundaries, the shape of the box, the strength of confinement, and so on. And it is an interesting problem to ask how qualitatively there is a dependence on the constants of relaxation in terms of how you fit things. Here is an example. Take the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation in the torus. And so put it in L2 space. Take a torus with variable size. Maybe it's a small periodic box, maybe it's a large periodic box. How will the spectrum depend on this? First, spectrum of this operator is real. This, I have to say, was first pointed out to me, it was 99. Carlo Cercignani were working on this, and he had made the diagonalization of the operator. He showed me, he produced the eigenfunction and so on. And then we had the complete spectrum, and I did not react on this amazing thing that the spectrum is real. Years later, I read the paper by Jean-Michel on this, and he points this out, and I said, but this is amazing. This operator is not symmetric. Why on earth is the spectrum real? This is non-trivial from physical point of view. When you look at this and you try to do the same simulations as I did, as I showed you in the Boltzmann equation, you will not see these oscillations. Spectrum is real, experimentally do the same, and you will see some nice curve. So there is physical meaning in this. But why on earth is the spectrum real? So again, I remember Jean-Michel told me it was an obsessing problem for him at some point. I don't know what you think of it now. It is very striking. Yes. And
a whole talk, sir.
Sorry?
I will give a whole talk.
A whole talk on this, yes. And another thing is the bottom of the spectrum, if A is small enough, becomes a constant which doesn't depend on A and which is equal to the constant of the Ornstein-Lundbeck operator, that is, if you take just this. So when your torus is small enough, it becomes a constant which is as good as if there was just the velocity variable. Take this other example, in which it is a confinement by a quadratic potential, not a box, and you make the strength of the confinement vary and more confinement and so on. In this case also, there is a saturation. You can increase your confinement, it will up to a saturation point, But this time it will only be half of the maximum value that you could expect if there was only the symmetric part. And then there is an imaginary part, this case, which goes to infinity as you increase the confinement. And there is, so to speak, some best choice in which you adapt the confinement precisely to this, which gives you, with least effort of confinement, the optimal rate of convergence. Okay, these are the two examples in which you can compute things completely exactly. Is this generic behavior? I mean, take a general potential, increase the strength. Will there be some saturation, some optimal value? I think this is physically relevant, and I have no clue. This is another thing on which things did not work at all, as I hoped at some point. There is all the literature about modeling heat conduction. People like Martin Heirer or Luc Rebelle or other people have worked on this. Stefano Ola and others say you take a chain of oscillators, you attach this to something that you control. Here is one oscillator, another oscillator, etc., and another oscillator. And you put some coupling potentials from one to the other, and you may put also in some models some pinning potential, which these are like atoms in a network, and you shake things here with some temperature, shake things there with some other temperature. You put some linear coupling between this here, the first position, and the parameter of shaking here, which is like white noise here. You put also some parameter here and white noise there. And you ask whether you can find a unique equilibrium measure. You ask what are its features as the number of oscillators go to infinity. And you hope to find in the end, in the limit n goes to infinity, a linear profile corresponding to a rest state for a heat problem going from some initial temperature to some final temperature. Okay. So far, we are still unable to do this. Let me remind you that nobody is able to show that to derive heat equation from basic principle. This is one of the most, I think, vexing problems in mathematical physics. And if all the oscillators are linear, then you can solve it explicitly, but then it's a disaster because the curve is like this, so completely unphysical. So it has to be nonlinear coupling that is at the basis of the linear heat equation, some kind of irony. And you put these models and you ask whether you have a good measure with a good Poincaré inequality and whether you can find estimates as n goes to infinity. I never was able to do anything with it. When n goes to infinity, you would like to recover something like a polynomial growth of the spectral gap or something like this. And it's very, very far from being able to do this. In all the estimates, things grow exponentially. However, changing a bit the model and the goals, Liverani and Ola were able to prove for a related model with weak coupling the hydrodynamic limit toward diffusion model, going to the hydrodynamic equation. Using both hypoelliptic Hermann-Oder-type theorems and hypocoercive methods of the same type that I showed you. Okay. Let's forget about this in the Riemannian case. In the Riemannian case, hypocoercivity in L1 is a mystery because of some bad commutator between the horizontal derivative and the geodesic flow. Let's forget about this other thing. And let me take 1 minute, I'm sorry for being late, for the last problem, which will make connection with some much more recent work of mine. So I worked with Clément Mouhot on the problem of Landau damping, which is when you take a nonlinear Vlasov equation in plasma physics, and you start from an equilibrium situation, you perturb a little bit, you ask whether there will be convergence to equilibrium again. And we were able to prove this under very strong assumptions of regularity, namely Jevre regularity, with a Jevre index that is lower than 3, meaning successive derivatives should not grow faster than the cube of the factorial. And you may be happy with Jevre regularity. As far as I'm concerned, it's okay with me. Or you may say it's not good, Jevre regularity is too strong, why don't you do it in Sobolev spaces, and so on. And really, I have no idea how to do it for the Vlasov equation with lower than Jevre regularity. It's essential to the proof. But since the real physical model is the one with a bit of collisions, you may ask, what about adding a little bit of collisions, of diffusion in the velocity space? and getting here a hypocoercive, a hypoelliptic problem. Epsilon in a real plasma, so this is the ugly lambda operator that I did not want to work at the beginning of my talk. The parameter epsilon in physics units can be very, very small, so it's reasonable to put it very small in epsilon. Now, the thing is that this operator will regularize, you expect it to regularize, in Jeuvre class, in Sobolev, but also in Jeuvre class for any Jeuvre exponent strictly bigger than one. Of course, there will be huge constants associated with this, but you should be able to work this out in terms of epsilon, in terms of t, what will the constant that will appear of regularization in Jeuvre class. And then combine this with a theorem that would be the damping for this equation. If you add the diffusion operator, it should not harm the homogenization properties, because homogeneity is a stable condition when you add the collisions. And you expect that on this, then you have convergence to equilibrium, which depends on the Jeuvre regularity, so it will be exponential minus t to the nu after some time. If you put out constants right, you need to redo all the proofs, so it should be a monster technical effort, you expect you'll be able to show a damping on a time scale which will be strictly less than the time scale of entropy increase. And then this would make sense, even in lower regularity, from a physical point of view, to recover the fact that this Landau damping effect is a homogenization effect on relatively short time scales. Okay, and you can try to get what would be the data and so on. Okay, that's it. I thank you. Sorry for being a bit late.